So Ben Finn OBE, he's the first of our OBEs today. His story is he co-founded a company called Sibelius with his twin brother, and that was when he was a teenager. He wrote this piece of software for musical notation. In the years that followed, Sibelius became the world standard that was used by artists like Sting, Ray Charles, symphony orchestras around the world, professional and amateur musicians alike. Once he got to his 30s, Ben exited for $23 million, or Ben and his brother. He was then awarded an OBE for his services to the music industry. He's got some experience of, like I said, building up a software company. I first saw him at an event for startups a while ago, and he had this very good presentation about how to prioritize features when you're building a piece of software, because you get all the stakeholders and other constraints pulling your software in different directions. And Ben gave a very good talk about how do you prioritize and choose which features to build and when to build them. So without further ado, I'm going to let him tell you exactly about how he did that. Okay.
Thank you. Hello, can you hear me? Yeah, good. Conventional wisdom says I should stand up and wander around and so on, but I'm actually just going to be lazy and I'm going to sit here. I'm going to be talking about developing products, not necessarily desktop software like Sibelius. It could be any kind of software. It could be a website, could be an app, anything like that. Whatever product you develop, you have to choose features. You have to decide what you're going to actually develop. If you do it right, you can make a lot of money. If you do it wrong, you don't make so much money. People very often do it wrong and don't realise they're doing so. So in my company, Sibelius, once we've been going for a few years, I started introducing a very rigorous economic method of choosing features, of deciding what we were going to do, in order to get us the maximum value out of our development. Now, development is extremely expensive, or can be extremely expensive. We have a small development team, but by being very careful about what we decided to do and what we didn't do, and by understanding what customers wanted and what they didn't want, we were able to produce a lot of very successful versions of Sibelius in a very short time. We did a new version, a major new version, about every 18 months, which and each new version had a whole lot of big features and lots of little features. And we did these for Windows and for Mac and in multiple different language versions and all this kind of stuff. So we were able to be enormously productive with a small development team by being very careful about it. Now, of course, there are always more ideas available than development time. We had a database of several thousand different feature ideas that had come in over the years, a lot of little tiny ones, but a lot of big good ones. And so we used this method in order to choose what we would do. As I mentioned, this applies to any kind of product. So if we're talking about software, it could be desktop software, it could be web-based, it could be an app, anything like that. It might be something which generates revenues, which you directly sell, like Sibelius. We would sell it for, you know, it might be £600 a go to a professional. But you might be developing software which doesn't directly generate revenues, but is generating users or usage or appeal or traffic, something like that. However, the same thing applies. Whether you're trying to increase your revenues or increase some other parameter, by choosing the features right, you can do it better. This methodology I'm going to be talking about also applies equally to other products, physical goods, services, because all of these things contain features. Everything has features. Now, what do I mean by a feature here? A feature is something you develop that customers want, that they want your software to do or want your software to have. So the obvious thing you think of as a feature is some kind of functionality, something which does something. But that's not the only features we're talking about here. User interface can be very important, very important feature. People may not feel that they're paying money for a user interface, but if you have a good user interface, it makes people find the software easier to use, it makes it look more attractive, so people do in fact effectively pay for it. Compatibility is another thing you might not quite think of as a feature, but suppose you've developed an app, let's say for iOS, and it's quite successful, and then you decide you're going to convert it to work for Android as well. Now that involves, of course, a huge amount of development, but it's also effectively a vast feature, because releasing an iOS app for Android is going to multiply your revenues or your number of users by a huge amount. So that is a big feature. Another thing you might not think of is speed. If you've got some software where speed counts, then making it faster is a feature, and it's in fact potentially a marketable feature. If you're, this may not be quite so important now that computers are faster than they were, but if your competitor's software is slow and clunky and yours is fast and slick, that's something people will pay money for. So, you've got a whole lot of features you might be able to do, but you've got limited time. How are you going to choose which ones you're going to do? Well, let's look first at what people, how people normally go about it. How are features usually chosen? So, you have to start off with a long list, a load of ideas for features. Where do these ideas usually come from? Well, they come in from customers. If you've already got customers, you will get some kind of feedback from them. If you don't have customers, there will be at least potential customers out there who you can find out or who will tell you what they'd like software to do. Now, customers, and in fact all these other people I'm going to be talking about, are useful sources of ideas for features, but they're not good ways of finding out priorities. They're not necessarily good at telling you what's important and what isn't, and that's the crucial thing. In the case of customers, the trouble is the ones you hear from most may be highly unrepresentative of the market. Let's take an example of Sibelius. The most demanding customers we have for Sibelius were often people with highly specialised requirements. So, for example, our software was used by all kinds of amateur musicians, schools, universities, hundreds of thousands of those. But there would be a small number, and we're talking maybe in the dozens here, of people like, say, music publishers, producing very high quality printed scores. Now, we designed Sibelius to be able to do that. But they had the most advanced stringent requirements of anyone. And so they would bend our ear and they would shout very loud and say we wanted to be able to do XYZ features, some of which features no one else would want other than them. Now, that's not to say these publishers aren't important and in some ways much more important customers than your average customer, because they are influential. If they give you an endorsement, that counts for a lot. If they recommend your software to other people, that counts for a lot. But nonetheless, they're highly unrepresentative. So if you only listen to people who shout a lot or people who seem important, you'll get a very skewed idea of what you need to be developing. It's rather an inverse of how it should be, because the people who matter most, who in fact in our case turned out to be the education market, turned out to be schools and universities and people like that, who we hadn't thought of at all as being important initially, they ended up being about 2/3 of our revenues. And you don't get teachers phoning you up or emailing you telling you what they want, because they don't have time to do that. They're too busy teaching and that kind of thing. So if you only listen to people who speak to you, who contact you, that gives you a very highly unrepresentative idea of what people actually want and where money is going to come from. The other thing I just mentioned briefly is that customers, when they suggest features, they're not good at solutions. And what I mean by that is they know what kind of thing they'd like to do, what kind of problem they've got. But when they suggest a solution to it, when they say, I want a feature which does X, that's often actually not a very good idea, because they're not experienced enough to think through what kind of features would fit into the software, what a good solution is. You're generally much better than that. So suggestions that come in from customers, you often have to slightly ignore the precisely what they're saying and try and think what they're trying to achieve and try and come up with your own solution to that. Right, the next source of feature ideas and potentially bad advice. It's your CEO, some of you might be CEOs, your CEO, your CTO, or indeed you. Now the trouble is that these people think they know best, and they're in a role to tell people what to do, and they're used to being listened to, but again, they don't necessarily quite have their finger on the pulse, or they have their finger on part of what's going on, but not all of it. Your CEO will very often have a quite good knowledge of the market, hopefully a very good knowledge of the market, but will not be an expert often at development, so that he won't know what, or he or she won't know what is practical. The CTO, on the other hand, will have a very good idea of what's feasible technically, but he will be very much more interested in that than directly in the customers, because you may not have much direct contact with customers. And you, whatever it is you do, or anyone else who might be in a position to make decisions about features, always think they know best. Finally, the final frequent source of feature proposals is developers themselves. Now often, particularly in small companies, developers are to some extent left to their own devices, for example, coming up with specs and that kind of thing. So they often get quite a big say in how features are implemented. Now that's not to say that developers don't have very good ideas for features. I mean, all these people can have good ideas for features. But in terms of, again, of prioritising, in terms of knowing what's important, developers, not surprisingly, are interested in programming things that are interesting to program, interesting for developing things that seem cool, but that is not the same agenda as customers may have. Customers often want very mundane things to be developed. What they want is something boring, but that's what makes you money, and developers may not be interested in that. The other thing with developers is that it's not in their interest to shorten development time. Developers may well be very interested in doing a big, complex feature that will take years to develop. And when you say, sorry, we want something that does a third of that, and it's much less interesting, they're not so interested in doing that, understandably. So, again, you have to take any suggestions for importance or prioritisation with a big pinch of salt. So, nonetheless, these people will come up, typically, with a load of feature suggestions, but how are you going to decide which of these you're actually going to do, or which ones you're going to do first? Now, first of various charts and graphs. So, here is a chart of potential features. Now, each blob is a feature. Okay, can you see my mouse? Yes, you can. Each blob is a feature, and I have to explain these axes. Things over to the right are bigger features. So these bigger blobs are big features. These small blobs are small features. And by big, I mean roughly the same as expensive. So bigger features take longer to develop. So that's the x-axis. And then going upwards, we've got more useful features. So features that customers actually want more, that benefit customers more, are higher up. So we've got all these different possible features. Which ones might you do? Well, I've just highlighted a couple which might often end up on a feature list. So we've got here a big feature, a nice big feature, big chunky feature. The developers want to do it. It's quite popular. The customers will quite like it. Big and chunky, very marketable. The CEO likes the sound of that one as well. Okay, that might often get picked. And let's look at this red one here. This one is not so big, but it's the most useful feature. This is the feature customers will want the most. Let's suppose you know that. So that one, the customers want the most, might also often get developed. So those are released now. It's not completely clear whether those are the most important features, but those might well end up on your feature list. Yes? Yeah, everyone agreed? Or at least they're very well seriously considering those two red features. Okay, we'll come back to that one later. Okay. So, now of course people don't even have a graph like this. This took a huge amount of work to develop this graph. This is actual data, which I'll talk about later. They don't have a graph like this. All they've got is a list of things and a bit of a hunch as to which might be more useful, which might be more important. So how do people actually go about selecting from their long list of features? Well, they use this method. This is the human gut. They use gut feel. Now, gut feel is what most people, most companies, even big companies, more or less rely very much on gut feel for selecting features. Gut feel, in my experience and analysing how this goes about, is a very unreliable and very poor way at selecting features. They're good at digestion, but we all know what comes out of your gut, and that's what comes out when you use it to choose features that way. So the reasons are, whose gut are we talking about? Who's doing the choosing here? You've got different people with different agendas here. Who actually gets the final say? Well, it depends. You know, it might be a group of people. But again, you've got the CEO, you've got the CTO. They've both got quite a skewed view of things. You might have a product manager who hopefully has a better overview of both the technical side and the marketing side. But ultimately, someone makes a bit of a judgment call without doing it in a rigorous numerical way. What happens in practice is people tend to choose features that excite them, that they are personally interested in, which the actual customers may or may not want so much. Or they pick features which will take a long time to develop, and they don't properly take that into account. So the features that end up being developed are not cost effective very often. And this is actually a key thing that I think gut feel is very bad at, is balancing the benefit and the cost. Balancing how useful a feature is going to be to a customer with the cost, i.e. the number of days it's going to take to develop it. So, how should you actually go about choosing features? Well, this is what I'm going to be telling you. This is what I'm going to be talking about. And I'm going to be going into immense detail, I'm afraid, because I'm going to be telling you all about how we did it at Sibelius. So I'll take an example. Suppose you're developing a word processor. Suppose you're at Microsoft about 30 years ago, developing a new version of Microsoft Word. And we've got a list of potential features. I'm going to suggest three features to you. One is a spell checking feature. Now this is an example of a big feature, let's suppose it's a big feature. Many users want spell checking a lot, but let's suppose it's hard to develop. So it's a big feature, but it's expensive. Next feature you might consider is a smaller feature. This is something to do footnotes at the bottom of, at the bottom of a page. Now a small number of users really want this. Let's suppose academics, they're publishing academic papers, they must have footnotes at the bottom of the page. But let's suppose they're only 10% of the market. And most people writing letters, that kind of thing, never ever want footnotes. So it's essential for a few people, the rest don't care at all. And let's suppose it's quite hard to develop. Not as hard as spell checking, but it's quite hard. Third feature on our list, we've got something a bit small and boring. So let's suppose page numbers go in the middle of the bottom of the page, but you want to be able to print double-sided, and you want numbers to be able to go on the left side or the right side, depending on whether it's the left or right-hand page. Okay, slightly boring feature. Now, many people would actually use it, but they're not really that bothered about it. Maybe as many as half the people might ultimately use it, but they don't care that much where the page numbers go. But let's suppose it's actually quite an easy feature to do. So this is your classic dilemma. We've got limited development time. Which of these is higher priority? Which of these do we do first? So we've got a big, difficult feature, a medium-sized but highly specialised feature, and we've got a small, easy, but boring feature. How do we balance all of that? Now, fortunately, simple economics provides a solution. Now, anyone who knows anything about economics, bear with me. This seems unbelievably basic, but people just don't do this. All right. Benefit-cost ratio. This is how almost everything in economics is worked out. There's a ratio. If you can work out the benefit of a feature, now what that means typically is how much revenue you'll get from a feature. If only you could know how much revenue you get from a feature and the cost of developing it, well, you can do an estimate of that, that's a bit easier. Then the benefit divided by the cost tells you how good a use of development time that would be. That is effectively, it's telling you how many pounds generated by the feature you get per pound spent on the feature. It's the same thing as return on investment. So each pound you spend, how many pounds are you going to get back? Now, this seems obvious, but to actually try and work out what this is for features is actually really very hard, because it's hard to predict the benefit of a feature. That it's hard to predict how much money people will actually pay you just for that feature. And people, as I say, very rarely try to do an analysis like this, but they should. So how do you actually come up with these numbers, the benefit and the cost? So in a bit more detail, this is how I think you should do it. Now, we don't need to actually work out the actual revenues you'll get. We just need something that's a proxy for it, something that's proportional to it. So the more people who are going to use a feature, the more money you will get, basically. If people are going to use it, they would be prepared to pay you for it. Also, if people who use the feature really want the feature, they will be prepared to pay you more for it. So if you multiply those two together, those two numbers, that gives you something which is proportional to how much money you would expect that feature to make. Now, it's useful to separate these two factors of the benefits. It's useful to separate these out. So if you think about our academics who want to use footnotes, now, let's suppose it's 10% of users who want footnotes. But if it's essential to these academics, let's suppose they give it a rating of 10 out of 10. You see how important it is to separate those two. These academics might be shouting very loudly for a feature. And similarly, our publishers and surveyors, they will be shouting extremely loudly for some feature. They say, we must have it, we must have it. It's essential. And they're trying to make you think it's essential. But they're not telling you how few they are in number, how relatively few they are. So you have to split them out. Now, the cost is much easier to estimate. And a good proxy is simply the number of days taken to develop the software. And that is something your project manager should be working out anyway, or should be working out in advance anyway. Now, of course, there are other things involved, like testing and bug fixing, but you can assume, it's reasonable to assume, those are proportional to the number of days taken to development. Now, just a little, anyone who knows about economics, I'll just mention a little detail here. I'm not expressing these in actual pounds. We're doing these in kind of arbitrary units. There are certain advantages to doing it in pounds, and certain cases, trying to work out actually how much real money we're talking about here, and how much real cost we're talking about here in pounds. Sometimes that's a better thing to do, but this will do for now. I'll also just mention that I've put a little approximation sign here. This is quite a good approximation of what's going on, but then there are other adjustments you may want to make, which I'll talk about later, going into immense detail, because this doesn't show the whole picture of what influences how much money you will make. So, right, I'm going to get very boring now. We're going to work through this example of our three features. We can actually put numbers on this. So, if you just bear with me while I put numbers. So, spell checking. We said most people want to use it. Let's say 75% of people want to use it. And let's suppose they want it quite a lot. They would give it a score of 8 out of 10, let's say. But it's a big feature. Let's say it's going to take 100 days to develop. Okay, so that's a big feature which lots of people want a lot. Footnotes. Let's say only 10% of users actually want it. But they really, really want it. They want it 10 out of 10 is what score they would give it. And that's going to take a medium amount of time, 50 days. And then finally, we've got our left and right page numbers. Let's say nearly half of people would actually use it, but they're really not that bothered. They'd only give it a score of 2 out of 10 on average. much. I mean, some of them might really want it, some of them might hardly want it. Well, that's the score of 2 out of 10. But it's a really easy feature. It would only take, let's say, 5 days development. So, then let's do our maths on it. So, we calculate the benefit and the cost. That times that is the benefit, divided by the cost is that. And that gives you your priority. So, we can see from these numbers that our highest priority feature is left and right page numbers, followed by spell checking, followed by doing footnotes. Now, this is called a cost-benefit analysis in economics, what this little calculation we've done here. Now, this tells you something which was not at all obvious from the previous slide, or 2 slides back, that actually every pound you spend developing page numbers is 8 times more effective than every pound or every day you spend on footnotes. It's really much, much better use of time to do page numbers than to do footnotes. But you can't tell that unless you actually put numbers on it and do the calculation. Now, it doesn't mean you'll never do footnotes. It means that you should do the page numbers first, followed by spell checking, followed by the footnotes. So let's suppose you've got about 150 days of development time, then you might be able to do all three. You start doing your page numbers, that's done in 5 days or so. You do your spell checking, and that's another 100 days. But suppose that overruns, it turns into 130 days or something, then at least you'll get that finished and you can drop footnotes. And that will have given you the maximum revenue for your development time. If you did them in a different order, if you did, say, footnotes first, then you started spell checking, and then you just run out of time and you haven't finished spell checking, so you'd have to drop that feature. So then you've got a version which is missing a major feature, and you'll only get a third of or something of the revenue, so it would be a bit of a disaster. Okay. Now that's it in theory. I'm going to go into more detail now. I'm sorry. That's in theory what you do. How do you actually do this? And the difficulty is how you find out, for a very large number of features, how many customers want them and how much they want them. That is not an easy thing to do. I'm going to show you the full process we did at Sibelius. Now, don't feel you have to do this. You can do a much simpler version of it. You can just use a bit of gut feel to come up with some numbers, but at least plug them into the formula, and then you'll get so much better results. So you don't have to do everything I'm going to show you, but a lot of it might be useful. So this is an outline of the process we use. You start by coming up with a list of all potential features. You then get a load of feedback and you get a load of information. You get a load of feedback and information, and that will tell you how many people want them and how much they want them. And then you do a cost-benefit analysis like I've just shown you. So I'll go into each of these. So how do you come up with all your features? Well, the key thing is having a database. Now, if you've got a little product, just a list will do, like a list in Excel or a list in Word. But we had a database, as I say, of several thousand feature ideas. And any time anyone thinks of anything that could go in your product, you get an email, you have an idea, you see a competitor's product, any time any idea comes along, it goes in your database. Even very unlikely ones. It doesn't matter how unlikely, they all go in there. So there you've got a repository of everything you might ever possibly do. Then, before you do a new version or before you do a new product, you talk to a load of people. First of all, you talk to internal people. Sales and marketing people talk to customers all the time. They have their finger on the pulse of what people want. So ask them, what are people saying they want? Or and how much are they saying they want it? And what kinds of people are these? Development, you talk to them. Now, they will obviously come up with all kinds of good ideas of their own. They may not have their finger on the pulse of what customers want so much, but they will have good ideas. Technical support, if you have technical support, like sales and marketing people, they are speaking to customers all the time. But of course, they're particularly good on telling you bugs that need to be fixed, but also on things that people are trying to do and finding it difficult to do and they're having to give workarounds. So that's enormously valuable. So you ask all these people what features they think people want. You can also consult experts. If you have customers who are particularly experts in the field, you can ask them. You should definitely look at all competing products and see and list all their features as candidates. Doesn't mean you have to do them, but have them in the database. And finally, you can do a whole load of brainstorming in-house, possibly with customers, trying to come up with novel ideas that no one's had before. And those can become USPs, unique selling points for your products. So, a bit more about just what kind of features are we going to include here. Right, sorry, lots of detail, but this is quite useful stuff. Now, if you're going to do a big feature, of course, big features can come in different sizes. Typically, if you've got some big, huge thing, you can do a big, fancy version, you can do a small, simple version, maybe a medium version. So for a big feature, you should consider having at least two different sizes of it, and maybe list them separately in the database or have some description of what the different sizes might be. At the other end of the scale, tiny features on their own are not very marketable, in fact not marketable at all. Some little tweak isn't marketable. But if you group a bunch of tiny features together, you can make something which you can describe and people can understand. You can put it in a brochure, you can put it on the website and people can understand. So it's useful to group tiny features together. It's also useful from a cost perspective, not to try and work out whether this is going to take, you know, 1 hour or two, but to have a bunch of them say, okay, we'll spend a week on this bunch of little features. Changes to existing features are obviously hugely important and very marketable. If you make a big change to an existing feature, you can even give it a name, and you can call it a new feature if you change it big enough. I've already mentioned user interface, treat that as a feature. Compatibility, treat that as a feature, maybe even speed. Now, this list can end up huge. Like, as I say, our list was thousands long, and so you need to exclude some to make it practical. I think bug fixes you should treat as a separate thing, so don't try and do a cost-benefit analysis on those. Similarly, other internal code work like refactoring. And also, you can eliminate early on features which are clearly unfeasible, and when I say clearly unfeasible, I mean ones that have a very low demand and a very high cost. If it's clear, they're never going to end up anywhere near the top of the prioritised list. You can drop those early on, but still keep those in the database. So now you've got a big, big, long list. What are you going to do with it? You need to get feedback on this list. This is where you start finding out how many people want to have it. So for each feature, you're trying to find out who'd use it, how much they want it. People will also give you feedback on any improvements or other suggestions that pop into their head when they read your about this feature idea. And you also need to find out, obviously, how much time, roughly, at least initially, roughly, how much time each of these features is going to take to develop. That's the bottom of the fraction, the development cost. So, who do you get this feedback from? Well, from all your internal staff you spoke to before, you can give them your long list and ask them those questions. Which of these do they think different customers would like? But also, I think at this point you can start spilling the beans slightly to a few external customers. Like if you've got beta testers, you can ask them, you can survey them, you could maybe have a focus group of beta testers or of users where you describe the features, then maybe have a mock-up for big features. You might do like a slide mock-up like in PowerPoint or something. Say, what if we did something like this? Would you pay for it? Would you like it? How much would you use it? You can again ask your experts. If you've already got products out there and if you're selling in a traditional way, like maybe software, box software like Sibelius, your distributors might have some idea about what their customers want. So, in addition to that, a final load of information you can get, but ideally you should already have, is information on your customer breakdown. How many different customers do you have of different types? Which features of the software, if you've already got software, which features do they currently use? How much do they use it? Now, you can get this kind of information If your software is registered, or if you have a website which people register on, you can ask them profiling questions, and that will give you some idea of the breakdown of your customer base. So this gives you a huge amount of information. This, just briefly, this is one of many different kinds of information we had about Sibelius users. For example, this was an analysis of what different Sibelius users use the software for, and we found this by doing a survey. So for example, if you're doing a feature which has something to do with homework, which would let you, submit homework or something like that, it's very useful to know that 29% of Sibelius users use Sibelius for homework. That's really valuable information. So armed with all this feedback on all these potential features, how much different people want them, you then do your cost-benefit analysis. And that is just a very much longer version of that little table I showed you before. So you go into a room with some senior staff, maybe these senior staff, with Excel for several days, probably, ideally, or certainly quite a few hours. You probably need a salesperson there as being an expert on the market. You need your CTO as an expert on development. And they try and fill in these numbers. So for each feature, as before, what percentage of customers would use it, how much they'd want it, and the number of developers' days. Now, these numbers you're not guessing anymore because you've actually got hard data here. You've got survey results. So, in fact, you tend to get almost complete agreement on what these numbers are. For example, as I say, if you're doing some feature which is relevant to homework, you can just plug in straight away that number, whatever it was, 29%. You can plug that straight in. How much they'd want it, well, you should have a fair idea of that, having got all this feedback. So you plug all these numbers in, and then you can calculate the priority number for the feature. Now, I will probably go rapidly over this next bit. There are various adjustments you may want to make to that. I mean, I'll just mention, for example, some features are intrinsically more marketable than others. Some features are just flashier and more exciting. And so they will probably generate more revenue regardless of merit. And conversely, little tweaks to existing features may actually be very useful to customers, but they're really quite hard to sell. People won't understand why they want them until they've got them. A classic case of that, I think, is new versions of operating systems. Like, why do you want the next version of Windows? It's impossible for most people to understand. It's got thousands of little tiny changes. You know, they're used to the old one. Why do they want these changes? It's very hard to explain. And this is, I don't know if anyone remembers this, Windows Vista. Its big USP, its big selling point, was this thing called Aero 3D, which was this view of the desktop where everything would go all 3D. No one ever used it. But I think actually it did make sense. It was highly gimmicky, but it made sense to include it because it was one tangible feature that people could identify and thought, that looks cool, and it probably made some people buy it, even though they never actually used it. Some other adjustments you can make, which I won't talk about. What do you get after all of this? You end up with a feature list, which is sorted by priority. It's a very long feature list, of course, because it includes all kinds of things you'll probably not get round to. But in practice, you can truncate that. You can chop off the feature list once you've used up all the developer days, all the days you've got assigned for the development. You should expect to develop in the order that features are listed on the list, at least approximately. Although pragmatic concerns mean that that may not make sense, you know, just because of what different people are doing, who's on holiday, that kind of thing. You know, things can be shifted around to some extent. And of course, you shouldn't take the numbers that come out completely literally. There's obviously a margin of error, but it's not that big a margin of error. In fact, if you do it properly, and I will show you that in a minute. In fact, I'll show you it right now. How well does this all work? How well does this procedure work? Well, after one of our versions, we did a very thorough post-mortem on it. We did a survey of all our users, and we asked them the questions we were trying to guess at. We asked them, this new feature we added, how much did it make you want to buy this update, want to buy this new version? How much influence did it have? How much do you use this feature? How much do you like it? We asked them those questions that we didn't know before. And we compared that with our predictions, which we'd made like maybe a year before. And this is how it came out. This is real data here. So these are our top 10 features. Now, ignore the first one. I'll talk about that. If you have a look, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, we've got 9 features, and 7 of them we predicted with extremely close accuracy, thanks to this process, how much people would want them. We had 2 mistakes where we grossly underestimated how popular the features would be, but all these other ones, we got it pretty much bang on. Now, this first feature is an interesting case. This is one of these big, huge features which we started out on. And then we realised partway through development it was going to go on forever. So we truncated it. We did a rather smaller version of it and recalculated the priorities. So we predicted a big, very popular feature. It had ended up being a somewhat smaller, less popular feature. But the cost shrunk as well. I haven't shown the costs here. So it does make sense if it looks like your cost prediction is completely wrong during development, to redo the calculation, redo the estimate, and then be prepared to either truncate the feature, make it smaller, or to drop it entirely if it looks like it's just gonna, if it should be disappearing way off the bottom of the priority list. So just to spell out what this tells you, if you can predict accurately how much people will want features, and you can, if you do it properly, if you can predict accurately, then you know you won't be wasting development time on features which people won't actually want. Okay, so I haven't quite finished. We've got a couple more charts to go. This process is all such a big palaver. Surely it's all too much hassle. Surely you can just rely on your gut, back on your gut. Well, let's see. Go back to this, remember this? Now these blobs here, this was in fact, these were the shortlisted potential features in that, I think in that same version I talked about. So this is in fact real data. So we've got here the predicted cost of each of these potential features along here. Remember, we've got the predicted benefit vertically here. So more useful, more beneficial features are up here. Bigger features are over here. And we actually express this all in pounds. Now, let's look what these ratios are. So this big feature, which looked like it was quite plausible, came out 2.7. So for every pound spent on development, we'd expect to get £2.70 back. Okay. This feature, which is the most useful feature, it's the highest one, the most useful feature, for every pound spent, you'd expect to get £9 back. This is just dividing that number by that number. Now, are those good features? People thought, I think quite a few people in the audience thought, those might end up on their feature list. Let's have a look at these ones, 152. That feature is more than 50 times a better use of time, development time, than that one. If you look at it, that little feature there is almost as beneficial to the customer as that huge feature there. They care as much about that feature as they will about that feature. Now, because this is big, and it's a huge amount of development, and it probably sounds exciting to the developers, to the CEO and so on, you'd be very, very strongly inclined to pick that feature. You could have done 50 features equally good instead. So picking features which are over here is a bad idea. The best features tend to be up in this segment, up in the most useful, least cost. Those are where the best features are. And so even this one, the highest priority features. So even this feature here, which is the most useful feature of all, is actually a very low priority feature. As I say, this is all real data. I'll just give you an example of a little feature like this. We added in one version of Sibelius, I don't know if it was this one. A little feature where you could, if you selected some music, you could copy it, Control C, and you could paste it into, say, Microsoft Word. Let's suppose you're writing some homework or something, writing a report or something, well, not a report, writing an essay or something, you want a little bit of music in, you could just do Control C and Control V to copy and paste. Now, a little trivial thing. Of course, you could get music out of Sibelius. Before that, you could save a graphics file, you can export a graphics file and then load it into Word. So it's a couple more steps. So we added a little feature where you do copy and paste. Now, this only took a day or two to develop. That, it turned out, was a completely massive feature. People absolutely loved it. It was a really big deal. We didn't in fact predict that. So that was a feature like this, which people absolutely love, and we just assumed it's so trivial it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if we don't do it. It turns out to be as big as lots of much, much bigger features than that. So clearly, now, clearly you can't fill your product entirely with features from over here because you're going to run out of them. But it will spread across to these bigger features which have a lower benefit cost ratio, which have lower numbers here. So, but nonetheless, you'll get a very high value result. How much better is it, in fact, than picking the features by gut feel? Well, again, I crunched the numbers on all of this, and I found that if you use a prioritised feature list, you end up with, on average, three times the overall effectiveness, that is three times the revenue, than if you just pick features at random. Now, I think if you're using gut feel, you're pretty much picking features at random. In fact, I think probably most people are doing worse than random using gut feel, because you tend to go for big features, you tend to go for highly beneficial features, and not balancing the cost of the two together. Now, as I mentioned at the start, if you're not working on software which generates revenues, then you may think this doesn't matter to you so much, but the increase in effectiveness is equally high for other things, like, for example, the usage of the software, the number of users, the amount of appeal. All of these will benefit commensurately if you use a process like this. And again, as I mentioned earlier, I've described a very elaborate process that took us, you know, quite a few weeks to do the full process. But it was an extremely good use of our time. Even if you don't want to do that, at least do some mini version of it. At least put some kind of numbers on how many customers want a feature, how much they want it, how much it will cost, and actually do the sum. It only takes you a few minutes, but the results are often extremely surprising. So just to summarise, I won't go through this, but just to cover the points I've made, don't rely on the gut feel. Make sure you get a feature list, make sure you get feedback, and actually do a cost-benefit analysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ben. It's always good to hear from someone who's done it before, and I think everyone today has done it before in their own way. Any questions from anybody?
A lot of what I've heard today reminds me of Lean Startup. Did you read anything about Lean Startup before? I'm just interested.
No. We probably predated it.
Thank you, that was really brilliant. I think it's amazing how you can sort of overlook something that's sort of so simple and so beneficial. I have one question that, I guess with this approach you're kind of following the majority of the money for the majority of the customers the majority of the time. If, say, you're in a competitive environment, you might end up sort of copying but never quite being as good as a competitor's software. And perhaps, so if you're a market leader, that's maybe the position you want to be in. Do you think there are other strategic concerns, like maybe you want to make that bit of software for the publishers that really does what they want, but then you're kind of and you occupy a sort of niche in that market. Do you think there are some sort of other strategic things to think about as well?
Absolutely. Actually, that's one of the slides I slightly skipped over. It's one of the adjustments, one of the big adjustments it's desirable to make in the cost-benefit analysis is to take account. Sorry. Yeah. Can you hear me? No?
Is that on?
Yeah. Okay. Is to take account of USPs, unique selling points, and gaps. So, for example, if you've got a product that's got a gap, and by a gap I mean something that a competitor's got that you haven't, then I think you should certainly put extra benefit, boost the score of filling a gap. Conversely, if you come up with a new feature that may not be that big a deal, but is at least unique, then that's a unique selling point. And so for people who want that thing, they're definitely going to go to you and not to your